one day at 2 o'clock in the night, we were sitting outside in a cafe, and he told me this story which he had in his mind for a very long time. I heard that story and I was like, wow, this is amazing. This has to be our next film. Mm-hmm. That's it. Let's do whatever it takes to make this film.
And you didn't realize it's going to take all of this.
No, I had no clue that it's going to take so long and it's going to be such an intense journey at that time. I had no idea. We were all full of, none of us had made any films. We were all struggling at that time. Mm-hmm. We only had dreams in our minds. So when you dream, you don't realize what the reality is going to be. At that time, I didn't even believe that it's actually going to happen, but our intentions were there. Mm-hmm. We completely got into it intensely, and the way Rahi got into it, it actually made it possible. I told him that this has to be our next film, and then I went home and I thought Rahi will take his own time, will take a year or two, and I'll have to push him a little bit. But the very next week he was ready with the script. And also the storyboard, which was about 600 pages long. And I was like, wow, if he's so much into it, then this is going to happen. And then our journey began. We started trying to raise funds for the film. That was a different fight, that was a different struggle. I mean, the script went to a lot of financiers, investors, production houses, studios. Everyone was excited about the film. Nobody rejected the film outright. The moment they saw Rahi's presentation, storyboard, and when they read the script, they were like, okay, this is something unique. And we have never seen any presentation like this. So they were all excited. But when it came down to numbers, it just wasn't sitting right, and I don't know, none of the investors had the confidence to put money into it.
And we are talking about 10 years ago?
10 years ago, yes. In 2008, we started struggling for...
It was a different time.
It was a different era altogether.
Absolutely.
Yes, we are in a different decade, and in a decade, a lot has changed. No, it would have been amazing if it came out in 2012 or 2015 when it was made. Any time this film came out, it would have been a good time. I think a lot of the large scale work reflects our ambition with which we went ahead to make the film. We were not subtle about it. If you meet Rahi, he possesses no subtlety. And I was completely taken in by that enthusiasm. We had in our mind that our first film should be the biggest ever. Like, we are going to make it for a big screen, big canvas. So all that subconsciously reflected in our visual style. And also because the film was set in a period, we wanted the audience to be a part of the atmosphere that we created. So visually, yes, it had to be grim, gloomy, and the idea was that once audience enters the theater, we should just grab them by the throat, and then we should not leave them till they leave the theater. Actually, we should not leave them even after they leave the theater. They should just be pulled back, and they should just come back to the theater to just become a part of it again. That was the ambition, the idea. Today I feel very fortunate that we actually achieved it through all whatever. The palette of the film was always going to be very limited because the atmosphere was very specific and we did not want to deviate from it. And that's why the film is shot in a very specific light and we did not deviate from that light
setup at all.
Outdoors, no artificial lighting. We always waited for nature to give us good light. Like, we always waited for clouds to cover the sky so that we could create that atmosphere of rain. And that rain happens all the time in the film. So that limits our lighting palette.
There is no sunshine. When I think about it now, there is no sunshine in the film at all.
We never shot in direct.
It doesn't have the only time resemblance of any sort of red is the last climax when you are inside the womb of...
Yes, that space was completely red. So that's why we limited the color palette of the film also. Mm-hmm. It was not going to have all kinds of colors, which is very unique for Indian culture, because in our culture we see exactly. all kinds of colors. But to create that mood, we had to limit our color palette. So it was mainly cold gray, bluish environment. But it will become very monotonous if you use only one color in the film. So it needed a very strong contrast. So we have red and gold, which contrasts very well with the cold gray.
Set to the theme of the story as well.
And also our light source was going to be only fire. There was no electricity. So it naturally lends itself very well to the film. The color contrast, or the cold gray atmosphere of the outdoors, contrasted with the golden lantern light of interiors. So the contrast was already there, and that also reflects in costume design, in art direction. Our one of the main objects of the film is the gold coin, so the gold is there. So we did not want to use any other color to distract the viewer. We did not want any element in the film that would take you out of the world of Tumbbad in any way. Yes, I mean, first of all, to shoot heavy prosthetics like this, you need to have a lot of patience.
And it should not look fake also at the same time.
It should not, but yes, first of all, you need very good prosthetic art.
Exactly.
And people who were involved in prosthetics of this film are exemplary. They're amazingly talented.
It's a really beautiful film.
So, Dhuri and his team had designed the prosthetics. They were very heavy prosthetics to carry for the actors, so actors also did tremendous job carrying on that prosthetic. Shooting the prosthetic is the easier part. The more difficult part is to actually make it. And our emphasis was to make it as realistic as possible. If the textures are right, the materials they use is as close to human skin as possible, or the skin of the monster that we are trying to create, then we photograph it like we would photograph human skin in any way. The house is covered actually with the roots coming out of that grandmother who is buried in the ground.
And then you have the
concept itself was so unique. To create that atmosphere, as I said, we had to put restrictions, because it was very important that there should be no distractions from this world that we have created. So that's why lighting had to be consistent, and the space. We are talking about the claustrophobic spaces. Even the art direction, the way the set was designed, it was not designed to be camera friendly or lighting friendly or shooting friendly at all. The space was designed in a way that you enter that space and you feel creeped out. You just you want to get out of the house as soon as you enter the set. It was an experience like that. Shooting in the house was very challenging. The camera was always in my hands. We did not have grip equipment to, because the space did not allow for it. So we had to figure out ways to squeeze ourselves in in that space. So the house itself was very claustrophobic. And then in this particular scene, when Soham comes back when the grandmother has transformed into this something extremely weird, where the entire house is full of roots and cobwebs, it was extremely challenging to move the camera through them. So we would have to rehearse, and my assistants would keep clearing the space behind me when I was moving with the camera. And we would keep tearing the cobwebs out just to, squeeze in the camera in any way possible. That was one of the very important visual cues for the film. I had kept that in my mind, that this is a film that that should not have any shallow depth of field.
Yeah.
It should have a lot of depth.
It has a lot of depth.
Wherever we see. And we will keep the camera moving in a dynamic way. And that is one of the tools we use to make the audience just get into the scene.
Get into it. Another thing I remember is when Young Vinayak, the grandmother puts the chains on his leg and pulls him.
Yes, that's
oh my
horrifying,
God, that's,
right?
You're being pulled with the camera is moving with the person. It's not like it's static and he's a villain. It's moving. So every scene, whenever there's so much of movement, you feel that you are the camera. You have the camera in your hand. It's your eyes that is moving with the.
Whenever the camera is in my hand, I always see the film from an audience perspective.
Mm.
Like, where would you would I place myself as a viewer to watch this action? You know, cinematic framing in most of the cases is, I find it very boring. I find it non-involving. That's a different kind of art when you want the audience to be distant and you just want them to observe a framed piece of art, you know, like in an exhibition. That's a different kind of art, but this film, unless you make the audience be in that space, they are just not going to experience the horror of that place. And for that to happen, it's very important that the camera moves exactly the way a viewer, a person who is in that space would move.
Exactly.
To watch this action.
Right.